in T Show. You know, it's been another great day for British democracy. Today we learned that the devolved parliaments were never told about much of the Brexit details. And in fact, it was deliberately withheld from them. At the same time, the Chancellor's Exchequer has assured us that if you're in the acting profession, if you're a dramatist or an actor of any kind or actress, then you can retrain and you can go into the caring professions. There you are. It's as simple as that. Yeah, straightforward. So the next time you're getting some nursing treatment and the nurse or carer breaks into song, have some sympathy. You know, they were probably in a different profession the previous week, thanks to the Chancellor. And thanks to you for joining us this evening. You know, we've got another great guest lined up for this evening, and I'm really excited that he's able to join us. Tonight, the TNT show welcomes Ian Blackford MP, head of the SNP Westminster Group, and we'll be taking your questions live. We've already had a whole bunch, but we'll try and take as many questions live as we possibly can. Now, you know that TNT stands for The Nation Talks. So in many respects, this is your show. Get your questions in. The details are on the screen. Either email me at john@cleish.com or use the data that you see on the screen just now. Now, to our guest. Tonight, The Nation Talks to Ian Blackford. Ian, I think you're the first HIB supporter on the TNT show. How are you? How are you coping with the COVID-19?
I'm good, John. It's good to be on with you. But I think you're surrounded by Hibs fans and your family and your wider social circle. So, no, it's good to be on. It's and I tell you what, I like the programme, The Nation Talks. That's a fantastic way of describing what we're doing. And, of course, the nation heading towards independence, as I firmly believe it is. No, listen, I'm good. And all of us have got a job to do to make sure we can help navigate that ship towards a better future for Scotland. You and I have been at this a long time. And what perhaps many of your listeners won't know, that you and I were in the same branch together probably more decades ago than you and I would like to remember, but way back in the late 1970s. So we go back a long way. But no, it's a pleasure to be on, and looking forward to the questions that are going to be put to me. Now, I understand that Kevin, who's responsible for a lot of this tonight, of course, as well, Kevin Gibney, that his father, Dennis, is 80 and he's had a fall recently, so I'm hoping he's making a good recovery. But on the subject of Hibs, I understand that he was a man that had a big soft spot for Hibs. He's obviously a fan of Auchinlech Talbot, but more worryingly, he seems to have gravitated towards Glasgow Celtic rather than Hibernian. So Dennis, I hope you're making a good recovery and come back to the cabbage and ribs, as we would call them.
They could use your support, please, Dennis. Think about that. You know, what I think people would be interested in, seriously, Ian? I mean, you've got a tough job. You're at the top of your profession in many respects, and you have this schedule which requires you to commute from Skye, where you are tonight, to Westminster, and I assume all sorts of places in between. I mean, if there is such a thing as a typical week, what is that like for you and your staff?
Yeah, well, listen, it's not a tough gig because I'm lucky. I've got a lot of good support, whether it's from my constituency staff or the leadership staff I have in Westminster. So they're responsible for an awful lot that goes on. But there is no doubt that living in the Isle of Skye and trying to be an MP at Westminster is a bit of a strange thing to be doing. So when I go down to Westminster, which typically I do on a Sunday or a Monday, it takes me about 8.5 hours to get there and 8.5 hours to get back at the end of the week. So you're really talking about 16, 17 hours a week that are wasted, yeah, where I could be doing something productive. And I've been down in Westminster for the last few weeks. I've had to do that because I had a role to play for us in leading in the single market bill and making the case that what we're seeing is that Westminster are interfering in the devolution settlement. So I've had a duty to go down and do that. I'm glad to say that this week I'm here. And what a difference, because that means that the time that I'd normally spend travelling, I'm putting into the good use of my constituents and my job as the Westminster leader. But, I mean, just in terms of the seat, it's the biggest seat in the UK Parliament. It's 12,000 square kilometres. To put it in context, it's the same size as Northern Ireland. It runs from the east coast to the west coast. It goes from the Black Isle to Ardnamurchan, if I can put it that way. It's a 4.5 hour drive north to south. It takes me more than 3 hours to get to the airport, even to fly down. And believe it or not, when there is such a thing as normality, I do surgeries in 32 different places. And again, you should never forget that you are the MP for people in all these dispersed, small, rural Highland communities, and you've got a job to do to stand up for them first and foremost. And actually, interestingly, I've got five staff, and I'm really very much indebted to all of them. I've got three full-time staff, two part-time staff. We, believe it or not, we've got a constituency of 54,000 electors. I've corresponded with more than 20,000 people in 5 years, and at the moment we're corresponding with more than 1,000 a month. So going through this crisis and how it's affecting people, when people often come to you as a last resort, we are under pressure, but I never underestimate the responsibility that you have as a local MP. And, you know, one of the things, John, that people often ask, they do say, what is the point of SNP MPs being down in Westminster? Why don't they come home? But one of the important things in all of this is we are there to represent the constituents that have sent us there. And we've got a job to fly the flag for the SNP, to support what the Scottish Government is doing. And all the time that we do that, all the time we try and get answers for them, all the time we try and represent them, we're showing them that the SNP is credible. And I'll maybe kind of deal with this head on, because people often say, given the disrespect that's shown to us, given the way that we're shouted down, why don't we come home? Well, you know, being down at Westminster, being a thorn in their flesh, being able to stand up at Prime Minister's questions, doing what we did last week, because they didn't like it in the third reading of the internal market, but I wouldn't sit down. I stood up for half an hour and made sure that they listened to the voices of Scotland. Now, I wouldn't be disrespectful to what Sinn Féin do. That is their choice, and for good reasons have got the strategy that they have. But I wonder how many people could name the Sinn Féin MPs at Westminster. I'll just leave you with that thought.
And none come to mind.
Well, there we are. Yeah. But you know Alison Sealis, and you know Neil Gray, and you know Joanna Cherry, and Philippa Whitford, and goodness knows countless others that I could mention as well.
Mary Black. We've asked Mary Black to come on the program.
Well, I hope Mary does. I mean, Mary's a colleague. She's also a good friend of mine, and someone that, I couldn't speak highly enough of the woman. She's an absolute gem. She's a star. And she spoke last week in the internal market debate. What a speech.
In fact, if you're able to have a wee word in her ear, I'm not asking you to pull rank or anything like that, but we've been in touch with her office. We're waiting to hear back. If there's any way of sort of expediting that, I'd be terribly grateful.
I'll give her every encouragement.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that.
What you're really saying is you don't really want me on today. You'd far rather have Mary.
No, there's a ranking in these things, you see. I thought you were going to say exactly the opposite there. You've got your total travelling time is, what, 18 hours, you said?
About 16, 17 hours a week, wasted.
That's extraordinary. I mean, yeah, I know. And I assume that when you're actually, you know, you're actually flying, so I assume the flight is at least an hour in duration.
Yeah, the flight's an hour and a half, so that's not the biggest bit of it. I mean, the longest journey is the journey between here and the airport. You are, because most of that journey between here and my home in the north end of Skye in Inverness, I don't have signal. So, and it's horrible because you could be having a conversation with someone in the bit of the country where you have got signal, then you lose it. So it's terribly frustrating. So no, it's mostly downtime. I suppose, I mean, I would argue that I've got some time to think. There's a wee, I'll tell you a wee story there actually, because when I was pension spokesperson, which I loved doing the first time I was elected, 2015, And I worked very closely with Ailey Whiteford, who was the portfolio lead, and Tanya McCampbell, that was our researcher. And I would phone Ailey and say, look, I want to come over and talk to you about things. We'll get Tanya in the room as well. And I used to come in and I would say, I've been thinking, at which point they would usually duck under the table, because they usually I've come up with some new policy idea. having thinking time is quite important. So I suppose in some senses, having that journey time does give me some time for reflection on things.
Yeah. When I used to run a major department in a multinational company, which will be nameless, I remember I used to do that. I used to come in and say, I've had a great idea, guys. And I used that to cover all genders.
You used to say that to us at SNP branch meetings, John.
Exactly. And so here's my great idea. And they were all very long-suffering. You know, they would say, oh, for God's sake. Because invariably it involved lots of work and not anything, any yeah. great tangible output. However, I was brought up short one time because we hired a Polish guy on secondment. And I said, so what do you think of this idea? And he said, well, in Poland, we call this pissing in the soup.
Yeah, I've heard that expression before.
That was the end of that idea. It never surfaced again. But you know, you have this exhausting schedule. You're there. You do Prime Minister's questions. You put the points. What a lot of people have said to us is that that more or less the Prime Minister flatly ignores to acknowledge what's been said. Yeah. So the validity, the value of the point that's been put to him is reduced because of his obstinacy. And it's not just you, it's others as well. But people are saying, well, hold on a second. In fact, somebody's just written to us saying, you know, I hope Ian and the SNP are going to make a move now for independence because I'm sick and tired of 47 years stuck in this rotten union.
47 years?
Yeah, exactly.
Short time span for some of us.
Yeah. Well, the country's been 300 years. Also, Brian McClurg is asking, could you ask Mr. Ian Blackford, please, what is the next step for Scotland, having refused to accept the internal market bill?
Yeah, so, I mean, these are broadly topics that have come up with a lot of people, and I understand there's a lot of people in the movement, John, are frustrated. They've said, look, we voted the SNP, we've given you a mandate, why don't you just get on with it? Why don't you deliver what we've asked you to do? And, of course, we all understand that. What I would say to people, if you think about this journey that we've been on, let's remember also we've only had our parliament that we fought long and hard for in itself for just over 20 years. Look how Scotland's changed. Look at where we started when we went into the first independence referendum campaign and we ended up just short at 45%. And the thing I would say to people, I'd say to our people, is that we needed other folk to come on that journey with us. And some people have needed a bit of time for that. And we all thought after the Brexit referendum that things would start to shift in our favour. And that's exactly what has happened. Now, rather interestingly, I had an email yesterday from a gentleman in my own constituency, a well-kent medical academic figure. He has been a member of the Labour Party since 1964. He resigned yesterday and joined the SNP. Now, the reason I'm telling that story is because lots of people are on their own journey. Yeah. And when we're getting disrespected and when we're getting a prime minister that shows contempt for our parliament, for our institutions, for the parliament that people voted for, okay, it gives us that resolve that we've got to make sure that we finish the job off. But whilst all this is going on, more and more people are coming towards us.
Yeah.
Now, when people say, can I just finish the point? People say, okay, you haven't been given the Section 30. What next? Where's your plan B? Where's plan C? Where's plan D? And I'll say to people, of course we have alternatives. But I'd say to people, please give us a short period of time to demonstrate that this strategy is going to work. And often the way that the question is put, John, is it's a problem for me, it's a problem for the First Minister, why haven't you got an answer to this? Actually, we need to turn that round the other way. And we need to say, are we going to the people of Scotland, not just the people that are currently voting for us, but are the people of Scotland going to stand back and watch a Prime Minister that's going to deny democracy, that's going to deny the right of the people of Scotland to choose their own future, where the Prime Minister can say, it doesn't matter who you vote for. If you vote for the SNP, we're going to ignore you. That's not a good look. And I'll tell you this, that privately, that an awful lot of Conservatives in government, on the back benches at Westminster, recognise that the position of saying no to Scotland, saying no to the people of Scotland, is not a good look, it's not a tenable position. And actually, I would argue in some respects, what they're doing with the Internal Markets Bill is that they're accepting that an independence referendum is coming. They're trying to set out the ground for an independence referendum. They're wanting to show the strong arms of the union in Scotland. That's exactly what they're doing. So I would say to people, let's make sure that we win this election next May I absolutely believe that on the back of that, we are going to get an independence referendum. And I'm asking people to stick with us for that short period to create the opportunity for others in Scotland to come with us that are not quite there yet. And let's be inclusive in this, because it's got to be about that vision, about the kind of country we want to be, what kind of society that we want to be. And let's build beyond the 50%+ support we've got now, beyond that. And this will become something which is unstoppable. Now, if I'm wrong, and I don't believe I am, but if I'm wrong, then of course we have to have alternatives. But we're not going to say to Boris Johnson, or anybody else for that matter at this point, that we have a different plan. Please let's see if we can deliver on the plan that we've got, as I believe that we will do.
I think people will be impressed by that. But I think it's what still remains, Ian, is that fundamental question, which is, people look at Boris Johnson. This is not about you and the SNP so much, really. It isn't. It sounds like that, but it isn't really, I suspect. Deep down, what people are saying is, we've looked at the guy you're negotiating with, and we have to tell you that we wouldn't trust him to find his rear end with both hands. We wouldn't.
I agree.
And why would you, a sensible person, along with your leader, who's also a very sensible person, why would you place any confidence in someone that we have zero confidence in?
Because at the end of the day, he may be prime minister, but he has to be able to take his cabinet with him. And I don't believe he's capable of doing that. And actually, there is another question about how long he's going to be there, because I do think he's using up political capital at a real speed of knots. What I'm essentially saying to you, and everything that I see, all the conversations that I have in Westminster, is I do believe that they are preparing the groundwork for this independence referendum coming. They know it's coming, and they know that they cannot continue to say no. If you look at Boris Johnson's interview with Andrew Marr on Sunday, he rather interestingly didn't say that he was going to say no after the Scottish referendum. He gave himself the Scottish election. He gave himself wiggle room for that, John. This is coming. This is coming, and we have to be ready for it as well.
Yeah, well, I hear what you're saying. I think what would reassure people, I think are maybe a number of things that might be tabled that would help to speak to that point. Mm-hmm. I think what people are looking for is a route map that reassures them categorically. I understand why you wouldn't necessarily want to show your hand right now and say to Boris Johnson, well, if you don't do this, then we'll do that. I mean, that is a negotiating position. That does make sense. Nonetheless, I think there's a whole bunch of people out there, and I suspect it's a growing number of people, and I suspect you know that too, who will only be reassured if they have some clear idea for a route map that says, you know, these are the steps. You know, up with this, we will not put. I mean, for example, somebody wrote to us today making this very point. It was an email from Pete Young, who's a Scot based in Denmark. And she says, an independent Denmark with its own
cost. Yeah, of course.
Yeah. And he says, you know, we were promised that we would not be dragged out of the EU, but we have been. So why have you not walked out yet?
Yeah, no, look, it's a fair point. And I acknowledge that, I mean, I've tried to be fairly robust in Parliament, and I said that we wouldn't put up with this. But the reason that we haven't walked out, John, comes back to what I said to you earlier. So let me go back to when I got chucked out and the group walked out a couple of years ago. The group didn't know what was going on. I knew that I had to make a big statement that day, so I knew what I was doing. And it went, if I may say so, according to plan. Now, let's look at that in the context of last week with the UK Internal Market Bill. And of course, COVID has reshaped everything. And I've got to be conscious of everything that's going on with that. But can you imagine, for example, if I decided that I was going to get chucked out or walked out last week, because there can only be 50 MPs in the House of Commons, and we can only really get 3, I couldn't have walked out with 2 MPs behind me. I would have looked ridiculous, quite frankly. So we had to try and make our point in a different way. But just as I sort of said at the start of the programme, everybody knows well, you mentioned Mary Black. Everybody knows Mary. Everybody knows Joanna Cherry. Everybody knows Alison Thewlis. But they don't know the Sinn Féin MPs. And if I lead the SNP MPs out of Holyrood, I take us away
out of
from that opportunity, a pain in the neck, to the Westminster government. Now, they will never know what I'm going to do at PMQs or anything else. But we've got that opportunity to showcase what we were doing. And, of course, I mean, it's different from the days of Parnell 100-plus years ago in terms of disrupting Parliament, but I will try and be as effective as we can be. But the job is to make sure that we are amplifying the case for Scottish independence. But everything, what I'd say to our friend in Denmark is that everything which is going on, the disrespect which is shown to us, the way that we are treated, is helping bring people towards us. Now, you know, there was an interesting thing last week when I had decided I was going to spend a bit of time explaining our opposition to the internal markets bill. And up stood this Tory saying, point of order, Mr. Speaker, isn't this out of order? That the Speaker from the SNP wouldn't sit down to allow other Conservatives to speak. We've heard enough from the SNP, why don't they sit down? And I thought, great, why? We need to make sure that everybody in Scotland sees this. That they want us to sit down and shut up.
Yeah.
But we're not going to do it.
Yeah.
Because our job is to be a voice for Scotland and Westminster, and that's exactly what we're going to do. And we're going to have to do that job through the Scottish elections, through the referendum that will come, and through the negotiation period. And I look forward to the day that I walk out of Westminster, and that will be the day that Scotland's declared an independent country. And well, I look forward to coming home.
Everyone watching and listening to this will be cheering like crazy. But I still suspect there'll be... Let me read you a question we got here,
yeah,
which covers some of the ground, but it will give you a chance to deal with a specific. It's from Peter Curran, and he said, my question is this. If faced with either a flat no to a request for a Section 30 order, or if faced with delaying tactics or attempts to alter the franchise timing or specify a vote majority or turnout percentage, what will the new Scottish government response be? And he goes on to say this. He's anticipating.
Yeah.
I will regard any answer that says this can't be answered because it's hypothetical, or an answer that claims there will not be a no because the case will be unanswerable and the UK must comply, as no answer at all and an evasion.
Oh, goodness. Well, I wouldn't do that, John. I mean, I mean, we all think that the Prime Minister is a bit of a buffoon. In fact, a bit of a buffoon is probably an understatement. He is a buffoon. But I do recognise what we're up against with Cummings and Gove, because Gove is the man that's behind an awful lot of this. And I would say to Peter and to everybody else, of course we have to take them seriously. And this is a battle. This is absolutely a battle that we are in. And we have to be ready and we have to be tough and we need to be able to take them straight on, because they will try and do the things that Peter has suggested. And we must make sure that we set the terms and we're not going to be bullied by this. But let me say, I think there's two things which are important in this. One is that, as I've argued, that what we've got to do is we've got to push support in Scotland beyond the level that it's currently at. I mean, I want this to be absolutely unequivocal. And I want us to be able to also deal with, I mean, frankly, the legitimate fears that some people have, because we've got to be able to bring Scotland together. We've got to be able to take the country forward, and I believe we can do that. I know the First Minister believes that too. But there's a second aspect, and it's equally important. Not, well, it's important, and you can argue about how you should look at it. The big difference from 2014 and now is where we are in our international relationships, and the goodwill, I'd even go as far as to say the support which is shown towards us by many of our friends in the European Union is vastly different. And we need to make sure that we can keep people in the EU on side with us, not just in the EU, I would say further afield. And I look upon the relationships that the Irish have in North America, for example, and think that we need to work an awful lot harder to make sure that we get the same kind of support that they get. So there's a diplomatic role that has to be played. And as the Westminster leader, I've got a big responsibility with others in making sure that takes place. But we've got to come at these things from a position of strength. We've got to be robust. And we're not going to allow ourselves to be bullied by Westminster when we get to the point of having these discussions that Peter has outlined. And we've got to be tough. We've got to be tough because these people are tough. And we have to be aware of the kind of challenge we'll face, because they were war-gamed all of this. Everything that happens is war-gamed by Gove and Cummings. Nothing is an accident. And that comes back to the point that why I believe the strategy is right, why I believe it will win. But I'm not going to take the foot off the gas, and I'm not going to allow us to become deflected, and I'm not going to allow us to go up a blind alley of other options at this stage, because the strategy we've got will win, and we've got to see it through to its conclusion next year.
So just so I understand it adequately, your feeling is that there'll be, at the Scottish elections next year, assuming the SNP has a majority in the Scottish Parliament, that will be grounds to do what?
To demand that Westminster delivers the Section 30 order to the Scottish Parliament to allow that an independence referendum takes place. And if I could just say one other thing on that too, because I know it's an important issue for debate as well. It's really important that the SNP has a majority, because that gives us the strength to be able to deliver that. And there are lots of other people I know that are pro-independence, and the Greens as an example. And it's really important that the SNP has a majority in this election to deliver on that.
And when they do, the plan is that you seek a meeting with Boris Johnson, or, as it may well be at that time, Michael Gove.
It could be somebody else. Yeah, absolutely. Or Sunak or whoever else. Yeah, so the First Minister will rightly want to go into discussions with the UK government about delivering these powers from Westminster to Scotland, which should not be time limited, by the way, because these powers should sit with Holyrood period. But the expectation would be that we would have a referendum in fairly short order.
Yeah. What would happen, do you think? And this, again, this is hypothetical, but as you know, I spend a lot of time thinking about constitutions and stuff. One way to stymie constitution secessionist movements is to, if you don't have a written constitution, is to write one, and is to write it in the Spanish model. In other words, to say that it is treasonable to even suggest that the integrity of the state be compromised, the territorial integrity. So in other words, it's against the law to do what you're doing now. It would be an illegal act, if you like. I mean, that would bring things to a complete crunching end, surely. I mean, where would you go from there? Look what happened to Catalonia. They're trying to deal with a constitution which expressly forbids them to secede. It says it is a treasonable act to secede.
Yeah, no, I know.
Something like that.
Well, look, the end of the day, I think these folk are unprincipled. And what we've seen with the behaviour, firstly on the withdrawal agreement bill, where the issue of consent of the Scottish Parliament was ignored because things were not normal, as they put it. What they've done over the internal market bill, they will stop at nothing, John. We've got to have that real sense of resolve that we will not allow our rights, our democratic rights. And the point that I've made frequently about the historical concept of, in Scotland, sovereignty resting with the people, we would need to appeal to our friends internationally. There'd be a massive job for us to do at home and abroad. I mean, like, you never rule anything out. I mean, I think that's probably unlikely, but you need to be on your guard as to everything that they would do, and you would need to look at the options that you have at that point.
Well, let me just test you on that. Right now, Scotland does not have the basic element of reaching out to people beyond its boundaries to say, support us. In other words, we do not have, like most independence movements have, at their very beginning, at their very genesis, which is a written constitution that says to anyone who's interested, this is what we stand for, and this is what we will not stand for. You can give that piece of paper to anyone. So there's no dubiety. There's no doubt. So if the opposition, whatever form it takes, Boris Johnson and Michael Gove, says these people are all nutters, et cetera, et cetera, don't believe a word they say, then you can counter that by saying, there you are. There it is. That's our commitment to the people of Scotland and beyond. This is what we stand for, and this is what we will not stand for. It's unarguable. Whatever form of government takes place in independent Scotland, it is governed by this. We don't have that.
Well, no, but we are. I think the one thing we've demonstrated over the course of the last few decades is the SNP is a democratic party. We are Democrats. We govern in Scotland on the basis of the will of the people, and that's exactly what we've done over the course of the last 10 years. What we have done, and we've come on leaps and bounds with the relationships that we have with the EU 27, with the EU ambassador, with various governments, with the offices that the Scottish government has now around the world. So we have a diplomatic reach that simply we didn't even have in 2014, John. It's massively different. And yes, of course, we would have to appeal to our friends to stand with us. You've got a UK that I think it is fair to say in some senses is now behaving like a pariah state. Mm-hmm. And you see that again through the breaching of the international law that they're prepared to do through the UK internal market bill. So we need to win. It's not, as I mentioned earlier, it's about winning hearts and minds internationally, as well as winning hearts and minds in Scotland. But provided that we can convince the people to come with us, this will become unstoppable. Well, and we need that majority support, and we need that real commitment. And that's why I'm asking those that are showing frustration to recognise it's not about us. It's about building that much broader mainstream level of support that we need, and then we will deliver.
Yeah. Well, we're doing a bit on the TNT show because we're reaching out beyond the silos.
Yes,
and we've already had somebody from the Alliance for Unity Party, George Galloway's outfit, and we will have others in the future who represent groups who do not support independence. And the reason we do that, even though this is the India Live channel, is for precisely that reason. We want to reach out beyond. We want to try and help people to move from where they are just now, perhaps, to an area more supportive of independence. Here's David Miller has written it on Facebook. You'll like this. He says, thank you, Ian Blackford, for doing your best to represent the people of Scotland, even though you and your colleagues suffer daily abuse at Westminster.
But you know, there's two things, actually. One is that there's a great camaraderie in the group, and we've got great staff. But also we know the level of support that we have at home as well, and that gives fantastic comfort. And I know that if we're not doing the job, then people back home will be very, very quick to tell us. Let me tell you a wee story. So the night that they pushed through the withdrawal agreement bill, so the night before the famous walkout, and it happened late on a Tuesday night. And you might remember there was very little time for debate. I wasn't even called to speak in the debate. And that evening, I spoke to three people, John. I spoke to the First Minister. And the First Minister said to me, "You need to do something." I think I was kind of getting that point. Mike Russell, who many of you will know, who's Mike's a kind of genial giant in many respects. Mike was in Dublin that night, and Mike was ready to man the barricades. So I'd had these two conversations, and then the third conversation I had was with my wife Anne, and it was a very short conversation, and it was along the lines of, "Well, if you don't do something, don't come home," and the phone was slammed down. So I knew that the pressure was on. And I think we made a statement the following day.
Yeah.
By the way, the SNP picked up 10,000 new members that day as a consequence of what we did. And a lot of these people were coming towards us for the first time. So I know the responsibility we've got, but it's the responsibility, it's an honour, it's a privilege to represent people. And in particular for me, it's about supporting the First Minister, it's about supporting our government. And making sure that we've got that one team SNP. And you'll have noticed over the course of the last few weeks that there's been a particular emphasis, not just from me, but from the entire group, of making sure that we're speaking about independence as much as we possibly can.
I do feel that's important. And I think it's also important to add whatever texture you can to that, because it seems to me, I mean, in many ways, you're riding two horses at the same time. You've got constituency duties, and it's hugely important that those are properly on.
You can never forget those. These are really important. Never take the people for granted.
Exactly. And then you've got another group of people, i.e. the independence community, the yes community, whatever terminology you care to use. And they also want you to put them first. So the question that will be in people's minds just now, they'll be saying to themselves, well, so which of those does Ian put first? Does he put constituents first or does he put independence first?
Well, I mean, I suppose there's an easy answer to that question because when having fought and won in 2015, 2017 and 2019, and if anybody looks at my leaflets, then they'll see very clearly they're voting for the SNP and they're voting for the independents. I happen to be the person that's been given the opportunity to represent people in this constituency, and you must do that. That's the bread and butter of what you do. But these things are not divisible. They're two sides of the same coin, if I can put it that way. But if I, as the leader of Westminster, and I've got a particular responsibility in that role, if I did not take due account and responsibility of my constituency responsibilities, then, well, frankly, I'd be out of my ear. Yeah. So you must never do that. And that goes back to the point I was making about having surgeries in 32 different places. But let me say that when you look at what's happened over the last few months, look at the First Minister, the daily briefings, the leadership she's shown, the number of people that have said they've come towards the SNP, they've come towards independence. You lead by example and you show by your actions. And the best way I can help encourage people here to vote for independence is show that we are the best people to represent their interests.
Yeah.
And to show by example that they should have the confidence, they should have the courage to come with us, and that the opportunity for us to really look after them, to create that fairer society, to create that prosperous society, to create that greener society. I don't want independence for itself. I want independence because I want to create a country that we can all be proud of.
Yeah.
And so being an MP is part of the opportunity to build that narrative, to build that story, to showcase what we can do, John.
Well, it's certainly, I mean, people I speak to say they're very impressed by what the SNP does at Westminster. But they usually end up by saying, how much longer do we have to spend there listening to all that nonsense from the opposition benches? Because some of it is just, frankly, beyond. I mean, it's... And in part, what they're actually saying is, we don't know how you can fool it. That's what they're actually saying.
Oh, you just... Well, my hearing's not the best, so sometimes I don't even hear all of it. But you've got to turn it to your advantage. And I'd say to people that I believe, I mean, you just come back to the point, you and I have known each other a long time. We were in the SNP in the same branch in the late 1970s. You go back a wee bit longer than me even.
But, I'm afraid so. Yeah.
Younger days than Ayrshire. But the point I'm making is we're approaching the end of this journey. And let's just stick with it. Let's just make sure that we've got that resolve, we've got that discipline, and we make sure that we can deliver. And it's our unity that will make sure that we deliver that.
Yeah. We've got a question about De Hont. Do you want to deal with De Hont?
Yeah, I can see it there. Look, I get the point that we're going to rack up votes on the list system. But I'd say to people, you cannot take the view that we will necessarily get a majority SNP government with the constituency vote. And let me go back to Dave Thompson, who's obviously been a figure in this whole discussion over the course of the last few months. And Dave I know very well from having been the MSP for this area. Dave was elected as a list MSP, and he was probably the one that put the SNP into government when he won that seat in the Highlands and Islands. And I get the point that we're only expecting to win a number of list seats, but we're going to need that to cement the opportunity to become a majority government. Can you imagine Westminster saying, well, we're not giving you a referendum because you haven't won the election, you're not a majority government, or we're having to rely on other people? Look at the fact that it's really difficult for the SNP just now as a minority government when it comes to the budget.
Yeah.
Let's make sure that we give the opportunity for everyone to vote for the SNP first and second, that we maximise the SNP members of Parliament. And it's absolutely unambiguous that we've got that majority for the SNP and for independents. And of course, we will welcome colleagues that then represent other parties, the Greens in particular. But let's make sure that we do our job and that we secure that majority for the SNP, because that's the best way to get that referendum and then build into that referendum that will follow on from that.
Thanks. I want to pick up on a point that you made earlier about the Westminster, the authorities there in Boris Johnson's ambit have wargamed this whole process through. Has the SNP done likewise?
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, that's a simple answer, but that goes back to the point. So, like, I speak to the FM a lot, probably less now than I would normally do because of what she's doing. But of course, we've gone through all of this, and you would expect us to do so. Yes, we have alternatives. But the point is, I think Plan A is winning, as it's often called. Why would you navigate away from Plan A when you believe it's going to deliver for you?
So your general point to people who are uncertain or unconvinced about what's happening at Westminster is that stick with it. It's going to come good. You've staked your reputation on it, really. You've said, look, I know this is going to work.
Yeah.
I think you said.
Yeah, I'm saying to people, people have been at this a long time, but I'm saying to people, give us a few months to demonstrate that the strategy will win. And if I'm wrong, then hold us accountable for that.
And by a few months, you mean the next election in Scotland?
The next election, yeah.
Okay. What do you think is going to happen over the next period of time? As you look towards midwinter and you look towards, clearly, severe weather conditions are not uncommon in Scotland at that time and elsewhere for that matter. You've also got Brexit about to befall us on a no-deal basis. And there's a strong likelihood that some of the loans which were given in the United States to entertainment companies, cinemas, shopping malls, these loans are going to go bad with a corresponding huge effect on the banks. So we could see a form of 2008 again. So, you know, that's three major whammies, if you like, you know, any one of which would overwhelm a very competent government. And we don't have it. We don't have that at Westminster. So what do you think is going to happen? If we throw ourselves ahead in time, say, to midwinter, what do you see happening at that time?
I have to say, look, I'm really concerned because, and I don't think the comparator is so much 2008, John. I think it's even worse than that. I think the comparator is what happened in the late 70s, early 80s. And I do think we're going back to mass unemployment. And I think the fact that the Tories have turned their back on so many people by not continuing the furlough scheme is just gut-wrenchingly awful. So we're going to have the pain of high unemployment as we go through the winter. And of course, we're having to experience that where we've got all the challenges that we have with COVID and lockdown and everything that's associated with that. And it's tough, it's difficult when we all know that. And I know what the FM is going through is just trying to navigate the way through that and think about what we have to do to try and keep people safe. When it comes to Europe, what I would say to people is the Tories are playing games. The internal market bill is part of the games that they're playing with the breaching of international law. Now, when you stand back from all of this, because there is this narrative of a no-deal Brexit, and I'm not a betting person, but obviously you would say that a no-deal Brexit is a possibility. I have to say to you, as I look at it today, I actually don't think it's a strong possibility. And the reason I say that is because I know that the EU wants a deal. Boris Johnson, what does Boris Johnson want? I think on balance, he probably wants one as well. I know Michael Gove wants one, but Cummings probably doesn't. But the two sticking points, the two key sticking points are fishing and state aid. And I really believe that they can't or won't reach an accommodation over these issues over the coming couple of weeks. I think more than likely they will. And the challenge for us, because they've tried to kind of create this thing about the division of Europe, this is classic Boris, this is the classic game playing. So he then turns around and says, look what I've done, I've delivered this oven-ready Brexit, and I've done this great deal. It probably wouldn't be a great deal, but the point is that I've done a deal. But so he's, everything that they're doing is about appealing to the those that voted Tory, those that are Brexiteers in England, those that came over from Labour, the red wall seats, and they all be cock-a-hoop. And we need to make sure that we get across to people, hang on a minute, whether it's a no deal or whether it's a bad deal, the economic impact on Scotland from this is bad. And we know that the kind of deal they're talking about, the work that the Scottish government's done, you're probably talking about a 6% hit to GDP over 15 years. Yeah. You're talking about £9 billion off the Scottish economy. So it doesn't matter if Boris does a deal. It's still pretty disastrous for Scotland. And the only way we can save ourselves is becoming independent. And it's really important that we don't allow folk to think that he's now going to escape from this, deliver some kind of deal, and he's seen as some kind of saviour. It won't be. It will be bad news for Scotland.
Yeah. Can we just come back? That's a fair point. Back to the internal market bill. People are increasingly concerned about what they regard as being, as I put it in my Constitution column on Sunday, that the Scottish Parliament will be emasculated.
Yeah.
And there'll be a couple of thousand civil servants representing the UK, putting in place all sorts of exotic garden bridges and bridges to Northern Ireland and all this stuff, all of which will founder, but they will make headlines and all the rest of it. But more seriously, apart from the waste of public funds, what about areas like fracking, which the Scottish government has set its face firmly against in a very popular move? Would that be possible under the internal market arrangements? Could a government minister in Westminster simply say, you know, I'm going to permit fracking in Scotland?
No, because we've got control over the planning processes, and anything which is already in place cannot be overruled. So things like what we've done on tuition fees, things like what we've done on minimum alcohol pricing and so on, these things can't be touched. But when I think there's the issue, the one that we've got to confront, and again, let me be blunt, that because COVID is dominating so much, it's been perhaps more difficult to get across exactly what is going on here and why people should be inflamed. And I think there is a big responsibility in all of us, of the wider independence movement, to put this across. Because the attack that's taking place, and when you look at Schedule 46 and 47, it's very clear that the UK government is giving itself authority over every devolved area.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the point that we should be making is this isn't just an attack on the SNP. It's not an attack on the Scottish government. It's an attack on the people of Scotland that voted in a referendum in 1997 for a parliament that Westminster legislated through the Scotland Act, that these were the devolved areas that should not be interfered with by the Westminster government. It's a very, very simple argument. It's a very, very simple point. And we need people to recognise it's the old adage that you and I would have used many times over many decades, that power devolved is power retained. And that's been shown absolutely by this. And the point that you addressed earlier on, what is to stop Westminster doing what it likes? What is to stop? I mean, I know this might sound extreme, but in the context of where we are, what's to stop Westminster shutting down Holyrood? Well, the fact is Westminster can do as it likes, because that's what it's demonstrated with this bill. So the argument to people in Scotland, and perhaps those that have been perhaps still considering coming with us, is that your parliament's being attacked. That parliament that you voted for is being attacked.
Yeah.
And if you want to protect its interests, there is only one way to do it. And whether you voted SNP in the past or not, the only way to do that is to support the SNP to deliver an independence referendum to take us out of this situation.
Yeah.
And that's the answer to the argument.
Let me put a slightly different question to you, if I may. There's been rumours, I'll put it no higher than that, though I suspect it could be evaluated differently, that there's a bit of softening in the Tory party in Scotland, not necessarily amongst its leadership, but a number of Tories beginning to look at the leadership and saying, if this is what we're for, it's not what I'm for. I'm a Tory. I believe in certain Tory values, but I don't necessarily accept unionism anymore. Mm-hmm. And there's talk of a split, perhaps, between conservatives and unionists in Scotland. because if you're a Conservative, you can see a Conservative future in an independent Scotland, because there will always be a right-wing vote. And so the choice will be, do I leave this and make my move later, or do I go now? So, do you detect any softening there?
Yeah, I think so. I know what you're getting at. And certainly some things I was picking up before the election last year, certainly speaking to some colleagues. Just as you say, I think there are some people that were Conservatives that were put off by two things. Put off by Boris Johnson because he's a complete charlatan, but also put off by that hard-nosed unionism that has come from the Tory party over the course of the last few years. And in effect, what has happened is that the Tories have become the repository in the main for the unionist vote. But it's not been a pleasant message, has it? I mean, the strategy seems to have been, certainly over the last few elections, say no to IndyRef too. But it's been pretty brutal and pretty bitter. No dignity to it, I would have to say. So I think what you say is correct, John. I think a lot of people will reflect on that and say, well, this is not something that perhaps a traditional Conservative voter would be comfortable with.
Yeah. Is that the emergency services at your end or my end? There's a strange clanging noise in the background.
I hope they haven't. I think it's the clock that's a bit ahead of itself. I must adjust it.
We've had a question from at Bearsden in Mulgay, asking about Martin Keating's People's Case. And what's your view on that?
One of the things I've mentioned is that, of course, we have different strategies we can deploy, different alternatives. But it comes back to the point I'm making that we've got to stay united around the strategy and the plan that we have at the moment. And I think, I mean, the issue of going to court, which of course is an option, is the timing of that and the premise that you're seeking to prosecute.
Okay.
And you've got a situation, unfortunately, and I'm not going to be critical of anybody and what they're doing, but in essence what they're doing is they're taking the Scottish Government to court over this. So I would just say, look, let's be cautious and please let's get behind the strategy that we've got for 2021.
Yeah. My sense of it is this, for what it's worth, because I'm not an SNP member, because I feel it would be invidious to do a programme asking people with different views to come on if I was sitting there. And also I chair the Constitutional Commission, and that would be irregular, to put it mildly. My sense of it is that there's a big yes movement. It's a very powerful entity. And it feels a bit neglected. It feels it wants somebody to talk to it, to do it. If I may say so, to do what you're doing tonight on a broader platform and a much more consistent platform, to say to folks on a very regular basis, this is what we're doing, this is why we're doing it, this is how we're doing it, and this is why alternatives are not as effective. I think that series of messages, and by the way, this is not uncommon. If you look across independence movements across history, you'll find exactly the same phenomenon. The closer you get to a tipping point, the more agitated people get, because they want it tomorrow morning. Everybody wants what they desire most tomorrow morning. And there's nothing terribly wrong with that. But it's a question of how you manage through that.
John, you're listening. Can I say to you, I think you're spot on. And I would always say that the movement is not the SNP. The SNP is the government where a significant part of this, but it's never been to the exclusion of others. And I think that was demonstrated in the main pretty well in 2014. There was that broad coalition. We were part of it. And we have to give a degree of leadership to it. But that's not solely about us. It's about lots of other people too. And I absolutely share that. And I do think that we've got to work harder in nurturing those relationships across the movement. I had a had a conference call last Friday, I think it was, with the Yes Highland Network, and a very good meeting for about an hour as well. We should not, I promise you, I will not ever take the movement for granted. We're a part of it, and we need to make sure that we create the opportunities to have discussion, to be part of what is going on. We have to work together. And perhaps we've not been, we've not been as good as that as we should be. I mean, I've given a commitment to the All Under One Banner people that I will participate in the events that they're doing. I did the one in Inverness right at the beginning of this year. But I mean, I commit myself as Westminster leader of the SNP that we will work with the movement. Why wouldn't we? It makes absolute sense to do that. So I will seek to listen to what other people have to say and recognise that we need the movement to come out and campaign. And the things we've talked about the single market, well, the movement's got a tremendous job to do to get the message across to the public. And we have to work with the movement in making sure that that happens properly.
Yeah, I think you've got, I mean, we can talk as ex-bankers here. I think you've got a tremendous asset. Yeah. It's a question of how you turn that asset to best effect.
Exactly. Yeah.
Do you still get a stick about being being the Deutsche Bank executive and all that stuff? Because here you are leading a left of centre party at Westminster.
It comes up from our opponents, but I would turn that around the other way. I mean, I was lucky enough to do what I did. I don't apologise for what I did, but it gave me an insight into how these markets operate. And we need the point that I would continue to make is we need fairness, and there isn't fairness. There's too much inequality. The system has to change. But I would argue that I've got some insight as to how the system works.
I think that is invaluable, it seems to me, because, well, you know that we've had a big debate here on the TNT show about modern monetary theory. That's going to run and run. And if we'd had time, which we don't, because our hours are so long.
Can I just say one thing then on that? Because the whole discussion you have about monetary policy, the whole discussion that we have about currency, and I know this is going to open up a whole minefield, but I would say that these things are a means to an end. And the most important thing is having the power to be able to create jobs, to create wealth, to create prosperity. And these other bits, of course, you have to get them right, but they're part of the process of doing the bigger things, which is about creating that wealthier, fairer society.
Yeah, yeah. It's been great. We're almost through. I'm just about to do the little epilogue that I do at the end. But is there anything you want to say to the folks out there who are watching and listening? Any particular thought or message that you would like to give them?
Let's stick together. We're all part of the one family. We all are desperate to see Scotland becoming independent. I believe it's going to happen. Let's make sure that there's space for us to have discussion. But let's stay united. Let's give the leadership to the people. Let's deliver the prize. Friends, it's coming.
Okay. And you're happy to nurture the greater Yes community and moving that process? Absolutely.
Of course I am.
Yeah. Great. Super. Great to hear. Ian, it's been a great pleasure. We never got a chance to talk about Hibs. We never got a chance to talk about Murrayfield. We never got a chance to talk about a raft of things.
What a season it's been. What a season. Actually, they're playing tonight, so I'll catch up with the game later on against Brora Rangers.
Oh, my son will tell me, believe me.
I know you will. Say hello to Scott for me.
Text already from him and his mates. Anyway, like I say, our time's almost up. A big thank you to you. I know you've got a very busy schedule. It was more than kind of you to give up a full hour. Thank you for joining us tonight. I hope you've enjoyed the TNT show. As ever, we have a formidable list of guests coming up for future shows. Next week, the Nation will be talking to playwright Alan Bissett. So get your questions in. How does he feel that the whole entertainment area has been affected by COVID, and how what the responses are like, and what's best for that community? Plus, he will no doubt talk about his plays as well. Looking forward to that immensely. Oh, and by the way, do look out for the Constitution column at the weekend. I give pelters to the Tory government, but also suggest to some Tories that they may be changing their minds about independence. And very importantly, please support Indie Live. Kevin Gibney and the rest of the team that put this together, they're doing it for you. They're doing it for you. I think it works. By judging by the number of questions we've had tonight, there's plenty of evidence that many of you agree with that, and I'm delighted to hear that. But support Indie Live. They do lots of other things apart from the TNT show. And plug into that. Look at the other things they do. And thanks again for joining us. And join us next Wednesday, please. And remember, it's been a great day for British democracy. Good night, all. Thanks, Ian. Appreciate it.
Right, thanks, John. Right, I'll talk to you soon. It's been good to be on with you.
The What's On Guide to Live Stream Events and Shows is now available. You can find the guide on the web at independencelive.net, on multiple Facebook pages, or go direct with the web link tvl.ink/whatsonguide.
This is a new voice for a new Scotland.
We are an internet radio station, and you can find us at www.indielive.radio.
We are a community of volunteer broadcasters to entertain and inform.
Click on the Schedule tab to find out what's on every day of the week. You'll see what a great variety of shows we have, and we're on 24/7. There's something for everyone, so please give us a try. We know you're busy people, so most of our shows are also on demand on our Scottish Independence podcast channel, available wherever you get your podcasts.
Indie Live Radio is a new voice for a new Scotland.
Join us. Thanks for listening. The What's On Guide to Live Stream Events and Shows is now available. You can find the guide on the web at independencelive.net, on multiple Facebook pages, or go direct with the web link tvl.ink/whatsonguide.
YouTube, it'll be YouTube/IndependenceLive. That's where you'll find the footage.
The What's On Guide to Live Stream Events and Shows is now available. You can find the guide on the web at independencelive.net, on multiple Facebook pages, or go direct with the web link tvl.ink/whatsonguide.
Hi there, I'm Cliff.
And I'm Russ.
We're from the Veterans for Scottish Independence 2.0 group. And we're just invading your privacy today to let you know that we will be very shortly pushing a program out on live stream to do with the veterans, their needs, as it will be during an independent campaign, the next independence campaign, and indeed in an independent Scotland.
So get yourself in gear, come and join us, pull up a sandbag.
Yes.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Wherever you stand, get the fresh view of what's happening in Scotland with iScot. Celebrate everything about our country with intelligent, in-depth insight from lifestyle, culture to puzzles. And all the opinions you'll need, whether it's digital or by post, subscribe now to iScot.
are dumped on the Clyde. Fighting wars for the wealth of the few, how many have died? You can bury my bones, but the truth of it can't be denied. Will you stand and be counted, cause I'll be there stood by your side. Hope over fear, don't be afraid. They're Westminster Tories, the Scotland's no longer your slave. Carpe diem, will you seize the day? Rip the chains from the unicorn, Scotland's no longer your slave. Will the media tell you that England don't want you to go? And the taxpayer-funded MPs tell you just tell them no. No! But in Manchester, Nottingham, Sheffield, they already know. And they're fighting for them, and it's only the start of the show. Ha ha! Hope over fear, don't be afraid. Tell Westminster Tories that Scotland's no longer your slave. Carpe diem, my friend, will you seize the day? With the chains from the unicorn, Scotland's no longer your slave. Vote yes for a future. Vote over fear.